Ladies and gentlemen, welcome and good evening. My name is Adrian Cowden. I'm a member of the Soup Community Development Association, who has, with Lori Wallace, our president, organized this evening for the candidates to speak and express their platforms. The protocol that's been determined is that candidates will speak in alphabetical order and for 2 minutes. When we've completed that, we'll take questions, and I'd ask you to focus your questions directly from the chair. Make the questions, not comments, and let's see what we can learn from our candidates who are going to hopefully guide us through the next 3 years. So I can ask Mr. Bennett to commence.
Thank you, Mr. Cowden, and thank you to the Soup Community Development Association for sponsoring this evening. And I've appreciated the opportunity of serving our community over the past 3 years. I hope that isn't 2 minutes.
Nope.
Not yet, it's okay.
And to all candidates for allowing their name to stand for public office. There are a number of issues facing our community in the coming years, and one of them, I believe, is our growing population, the density that we're facing, the inevitable growth that we're facing, and how we're going to cope with that growing population, and to build that around our official community plan, which was approved last year. Jobs and the economy are important. I will continue to work for more jobs to become available to Sioux people, so that we have more people living and working here in Sioux. The transportation network. Yes, it would be lovely to have a four-lane highway all the way to Sioux, but to be realistic, I would work with the MOT and other levels of government to try and make some of the curves on Highway 14 safer, to ensure that there are cycling shoulders all the way to Sioux. I would work hard to make sure that the ENN line is restored to service so that more commuters can be taken from the West Shore into Victoria, and three or four trains running in the morning, three or four trains running in the afternoon to relieve some of the congestion. I would continue to work on having our connector road put in to have some of the pressure taken off of Highway 14 that runs through our downtown area. And I would also work very hard to have a more user-friendly schedule for transit. When clients for the crisis center have to go into Victoria to cash their check, it's basically a 5-hour return trip by transit. That is not reasonable. I would continue to support our town center plan, which is going to be the heart of our community in the coming years. With regard to taxation, I am a taxpayer like everybody else in this room. I would be a hardworking steward of our funds. It is easy to campaign on lowering taxes, but I would think you would find there isn't very much to lower. There isn't much in the way of fluff at District Hall.
Time.
The Occupy Wall Street movement, thank you, is an important aspect. I would also focus on housing options, on community safety, and I am a man of action. The candidate that you see in my platform is the candidate you see here, and I look forward to serving our community for a further 3 years in the capacity of mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Ms. Beach.
For inviting us here. As we all know, Sioux is a growing town. The Sioux School District is one of approximately 6 school districts which are the fastest growing in the province. The numbers of families arriving to schools in the district of Sioux certainly tell us that housing starts are important and affordability of these homes is paramount. We as a town are lucky to have children coming to live in Sioux. Families make the town vibrant. Our downtown core is moving slowly towards development. As we do this, I hope that we can create jobs and infrastructure that will bring people together. Sustainability is an important word word for many who wish to live and work in Souk. The words for sustainability from the United Nations, which can also stand for Souk, are the ability to meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. Developing the core of the town is an important issue. We all have a stake in how we wish to see it grow and prosper. My vision of Souk includes it becoming a visible arts community. At present, the Souk Region Cultural Planning Task Force is working to integrate culture into policies and planning in all development in the local government. This is also the mandate for the Souk Program of the Arts. The volunteers in all organizations are developing amazing strategies in all areas of Souk. From Food Chi, the Agricultural Plan, and award-winning Liquid Waste Management Plan, make other initiatives make Souk a town of which we can all be proud. Thank you.
Thank you for the speech. Our next speaker will be Ms. Berger. Welcome.
Thank you. Sorry for running last minute. Three kids. Always crazy. Thank you. Thank you for having me. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Beth Berger, like Mr. Kennedy just said, and I was born and raised in Souk. I attended Sousou Elementary all the way through grade 7, and then I graduated at Edinburgh Community School. I moved away from Souk for roughly 10 years, and during that time, I pursued a career in business, as well as started a family. I moved back to Souk with my husband, Kevin, and our three children in 2006. At that time, we started our own company here in Souk, as well as bought our house and really laid down some roots. It was time for me to be back home. In 2008, I was elected to my first term on council. These past 3 years have been very exciting as well as frustrating. As a new councillor, I found myself under stacks of books and paperwork for nearly the first year, trying to understand bylaws, policies, how to create bylaws, how to create policies. Parliamentary procedure and provincial regulation can be quite an overwhelming experience for your first time. I initially ran for council thinking that it would be fun and a really great way to give back to my community. Here I am today, 3 years later, and I stand for exactly the same thing. It's a great way to give back to my community. There's no simple life. There's one thing I have learned in the last 3 years. Sorry, a few things I've learned in the last few years. For example, there's no simple word for a word like sustainability, and that the term affordable and attainable housing is not an easy feat. I've also learned that being on council does not mean that I can single-handedly change the face of our community, nor can I put forward tons of ideas and hopes to, or sorry, with wishes and hopes and, that's what I'm looking for here, sorry, with wishes and hopes and how to change it all on my own. I'm only one of seven at a table. It takes teamwork, it takes respect, and it takes a lot of collaboration. What I feel is a positive point on council is that we're seven different people with seven different perspectives, all working for the betterment of our community. At the back, eventually, as soon as my husband gets here, sorry, there'll be some pamphlets. I'm just gonna give a quick little overview. I believe that if we work for three small goals or four small goals, then that can be attainable and we can work really hard and get them done together rather than a bunch.
Mike Colbert in the Irish tradition. This is my daddy. Well, I'm a little different, and I'm a little different in a very different way. I retired out here and I found the most incredible place that I could have ever imagined being, with the most incredible group of people all around me in every way. I see things in the community in terms of communication. I see things and questions in the community about communication. I feel that you know, we are at such a place in our youth as a community that we are needing to be and bond together in such a way that there is trust from top to bottom, that everybody knows that everybody else that's involved in the administration and running from councilship right into the, all of the administrative levels is a unit. You know, that's what we are. We're the residents, the administration, and the elected representatives of the district of Souk, and this is one unit out here. The amount of energy and strength that I see within that is incredible. You know, I could not imagine anything that would get in the way of us doing whatever we want. With that said, there's always going to be things that people want. Different groups want different things. You know, development at this point in time in our community, in our culture, is something that I feel very strong about. It was the reason why I accepted to come and talk here. I was actually quite charmed to get an invitation to come and talk at this particular society's meeting. I feel that it is what will make the difference between going to a wonderful place or having staggered falls, okay, in a big way. And what I'm saying there, you know, just to be maybe even more clear, is the unity of council, the unity of residents. You know, nobody has to agree there's always two sides to every coin, as long as we respect each other. I like to say that word out loud, and I like to say the word wholesome an awful lot, because I'm really clear as to what is wholesome. You know, when things are wholesome, they're good for everybody. And that's a really important thing. Those of you that know me know quite a bit about what I do. I'm not into that right now in terms of talking about that. I'm somebody who knows how to, and I'll finish. I'm somebody who knows how to interact with people at different levels of professional stature, right up to the top levels of government, right into industry, right into labor. I've been a laborer, and I'm very happy to have been. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Colbert. Mr. Dumont?
I'm Ron Dumont. I've lived in the district for about 58 years. Was a regional director for the whole area 28 years ago, and I've seen a lot of changes in Souk. We've come up with an incorporation 12 years ago for this next term of we teenagers. We've had the problems with us as children, so I hope we're going to do better when we're in our teenage. Souk started in a very deep hole because this community was a industrial commercial entity for many, many years with our logging and fishing, and so there was lots of money, lots of jobs in the community, but that has all disappeared, and the whole economy of the whole province and us have been falling into that for a long time. Now, one of the things that we did in the first term of the council was look at what we needed to get jobs in Souk and to promote development and orderly development of the community. And one of the things that we came up with is growth and people coming to the community does not make taxes lower. We came to the conclusion that industry and commerce in the community was what will help pay those taxes. And so in that endeavor, we decided we needed infrastructure. Thus, we had the sewer, the liquid waste management, parks, and so we have all the infrastructure needed now to encourage people to come to Souk for commerce, cut down the number of people that go on that road. So I'm pledging to work towards that same goal all the time, to be a sustainable community on its own. I've insisted that Souk is the center of the commercial area from Port Renfrew right back to East Souk, and even people shopping for from up on the Malahat because it's a much more comfortable place. Thank you very much. Do my best.
The timekeeper here needs a moment to figure out how to use this.
Not a different.
I actually like a timekeeper operator, which would be even
better. Do you want just a stopwatch one?
I resorted to the stopwatch method. Thank you. This is all very sophisticated for any two-year-old, I'm sure. Thank you, Gaines, Mr. Dumont, Mr. Haldane.
Hi, my name is Herb Haldane. Some of you have probably heard about me over the last 3 years. For me, this is all about democracy. And as Bev said, you've got seven different people with seven different opinions. And we're not always going to agree on everything. And that's happened, and it's been a tough 3 years. And it's been a hard 3 years for me, I'll tell you. But this has been about trying to come to a consensus and try to understand. You know, a lot of us were new this time around. There was four of us, and we all came on. And in the 3 years, it takes pretty much that entire 3 years to learn. You have to learn in order to be able to do a decent job. I mean, it's my understanding now that if we have a strong leader and we have strong leadership, then you can get a core group of people to work together, and you can probably come to a better consensus and better understanding. But in my case here, whatever, I've had a difference of opinion on lots of things, but I've learned a lot of stuff. I've checked into a lot of information. I've done my homework. I've worked hard, and I believe it's because honesty and integrity is the forefront. My family's lived here, so I mean, since the early 50s, so I'm in the same boat as a lot of people. I hope to keep working for you in the future and for the next 3 years, so I hope I have your support. I'm not going to go on lots about the details and stuff. I'm hoping you can ask some pertinent questions during this period here, but I'm willing to keep working for you, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Haldane. Mr. Kassler, please.
Great, thank you very much. You know, this is the first step in what I would call a conversation in this community, something that I've seen lacking over the past 3 years. What we have to do is get together and put together a way of establishing trust and transparency in how business is done in Souk. The issues are wide-ranging. And I don't think any one of us is going to have all the right answers for everybody. We're not miracle workers. But it's about doing the right thing for the community as a whole. What we have to do is make sure that reasoned decisions are made, and we bear in mind how the impact of those decisions is going to have on working families, our youth, and our seniors in this community. That's something that I've seen lacking over the past 3 years. So I pledge to work with the community, to work with the council members, whoever they may be, to make sure that we go on to the things that we strive for when this area incorporated in 1999. We've lost sight of that. We've made some decent progress since then, but we've lost sight of those basic fundamentals, and that is getting the people involved, getting them to help us make proper decisions that in their best interest, your best interest, in the future pursuit. Thank you.
Brevity seems to be the current theme. Thank you, Mr. Pastor. Please, Mr. Martin.
My name is Terrence Martin. Thank you all for investing your valuable time and coming out. And I'm honored to be running for council here in Langford. Sorry, but the new bus bench is not only for where I was for a minute there. I'm running for both Souk Council and Milne's own school trustee. With 8 natural children and a host of international students and foster kids, I'm partly to blame for the surge in growth, so I feel I should step up and shoulder some responsibility in both offices. For my bona fides, I've been in business for nearly 30 years. I'm a project manager and I have a master's degree in communication culture. I moved to Sun River States in 2005 with my wife, and now I have 2 children entering the school system within the upcoming electoral term. To me, growth is the most pressing issue facing our district, both controlling it and keeping it going in a sustainable manner. It impacts everything in the community, notably for schools, transportation, infrastructure, service levels, and most particularly our taxes, which is what nearly everything rolls up into, and lower taxes is the platform I'm running on. Some would say if you lower taxes, you have to lower your expectations, and I disagree. That box over there is my little handout. There's a little chart in my brochure that illustrates the problem. And the problem is spending. The spending plan depends on growth projections that have never materialized, and the result has been multi-digit tax increases. My own residential taxes have increased 65% since I moved here in 2005, and that has to stop. We have to spend our money more wisely in getting more bang for the buck and allocating it to foundation priorities. We cannot tax our way to prosperity. We also have to get the delay out of the development cycle. We need a frugal plan for Sooke that attracts families to live here while respecting the generations that have built Sooke in the first place, particularly those who are on a fixed income. Owning property that's worth $1 million is little consolation if you have to sell your home to pay your tax bill. If we get the fundamentals right, new businesses, jobs, roads, sidewalks, and better transit will follow you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Martin.
Good evening, welcome, thank you for coming tonight. I'm going to tell you a bit about myself and why I think I would make a good candidate for mayor. I came here in 1969, met my wife here. I was stationed here in the RCMP three times, finally moving here in 1985 to stay here permanently. So I've been here for 26 years. After I got out of the RCMP, I went to BC Transit. I was the head security manager of operations and finally the director of operations and maintenance. And I had a staff of 550 people, 250 vehicles, and a $57 million budget, so it gave me a pretty good exposure to business. I've been involved in the community in a number of ways. I was a trustee with the Fire District Chairman of the Board. I was on the Sooke Incorporation Committee and actually nominated Ed McGregor, our first mayor. Edward Millen Community School Society, I was a founding board member. Sooke Minor Hockey, referee, coach, manager, vice president, president. Lions Club and the Sooke Legion. So I feel I have experience in managing people, conflict, large budgets. I know how to run a meeting, procedures, I know how to do bylaws, resolution preparation, I know about in-camera meetings and the guidelines around those things. I'm running for mayor because I believe that we can and should have a council that cooperates and ensures that we have transparent decision making so you people in the community know what's going on. A council that consults with the community in a meaningful way, and you've got to respect people's rights to ask questions. We need to have a sustainable level of taxes. A 65% tax increase over the last 5 years is not on. The council has passed in their five-year plan a 27% tax increase over the next 5 years based on a 4% growth. And the growth projections have always been out of whack. And so if that is lower than that, that tax increase could spiral to 38% if we don't get careful spending in line. So growth in Sooke is only going to come with affordability. And we're fast approaching the point where it's not affordable to live here anymore for people paying their taxes. We need a well-defined strategic plan for our development with a consistent theme, and I believe a consistent West Coast theme. We need to provide some leadership in our downtown revitalization with access. I want people to say, hey, I'm proud to live in Sooke, and I can't say that I've talked to many people that talk about being proud about our downtown core. 11 years after incorporation, we're no further. So anyhow, I say no more studies, let's implement some plans, and I believe I have the background and the ability to provide some strong leadership. Thank you for your time.
Thank you all for attending and taking an interest in our local politics. This is a really important election for Sooke. We've got to get our finances in order. That's the bottom line here. I'm a numbers guy and I'm going to put my time into trying to do that. Sooke Council, I don't think, realizes how close to the brink of bankruptcy they brought us. In the last 3 years, they wiped out more than half of the cash flow that's the funds used to pay ongoing bills. If anybody's dealt with the district, they know they have to wait sometimes 5 months to get paid for certain bills. That's just atrocious. And right now they're borrowing at the beginning of the year, and they have to wait till June to get their money at the when the tax money comes in. So there are all those extra finance charges. It's the same as going to Money Mart for a payday loan. That's the extent of it right now. It's just really ridiculous. Next thing is we've got to reduce our taxes. There's more and more seniors, and it's not even seniors anymore, they're having to defer their taxes just to stay in their own homes. That's another thing that's got to be stopped. The spending is just totally out of control, and the current council has increased the taxes. My numbers are 63% on the total that they project to increase in the next five-year plan. And that doesn't include anything to do with the extra payments of 50% that they're already paying to EPCOR. And that deal was done on a five-year plan, so they didn't need to go to a referendum like everybody or the majority of people in town wanted a referendum on that. So it's just the council is doing their own little thing, spending money, and it's hitting everybody's pocketbooks here. And it doesn't need to be done. My little building on where I have my office on Souk Road was $11,000 taxes a few years ago. Now it's over $28,000 for the last 3 years. What have we got for it? I should say, now we've got some benches out in front of the bus stops. And now they're contrary to the sign bylaw. And find out the Souk Council doesn't even know what the approved plan was for those things. It was just done by staff. And so staff has got to be told no sometimes. And they got a budget of $3 million for staffing for 30 people. So you work out the math of how much everybody's getting paid right now for being in the loop and trying to get proper people in suit. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Pearson, please.
Hi, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Kevin Pearson. I was born here 54 years ago. My wife and I have raised our three children. She comes from a long history of Souk people. My children are actually sixth generation Soukites, so we have a long-standing history in the community, and we love this community. My first pledge to everybody is that we need to, my role has to be part of a functioning council. If the council can't function, we can't go ahead with any of the other plans that we have. So I endeavor to support the council, learn about what that process is, and understand the issues that are that come forth to the council. I have a couple of my own that I think are priorities, and obviously, you know, they've been talked about, but taxation. We can't promise to reduce taxes, but you know what we can promise is careful spending. And that's really essential to the tax revenue that we have. If we don't spend that money wisely, we don't get value for the money. And I think that that's what a lot of people are questioning right now, is the value of the money that's going out. Okay? Jobs and economy. You know, we used to have an economic engine of a resource-based town. That disappeared a long time ago. And so our economic engine has to be things like affordable housing. And for our business core, we've got a commuting public that goes into Victoria every single day, spending $100 a week on gas, and they're driving right by on the way home. They're driving by the Costco's and the Walmart's and things like that. So if we're going to tax our local businesses, you're going to hammer them. So we have to, as a council, come with ways to help people be successful in the business. Okay? And the growing population. Obviously, that's a challenge for all of us that have lived here, but we can do it. We can plan that out. We have an infrastructure that's put in place. We have a downtown core that's outlined by that sewer. And you know what? We're talking about expanding a sewer system, and we haven't even infilled the area that we have now. So let's get on that plan, infill, and make the best of the system that we already have. So I really don't have a lot more to say other than I'm a process guy, and when I understand the process, I think we have to follow it, and we have to have a transparent and fair council so that everyone feels that they're part of our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Pearson. Ms. Ray, please.
Good evening. My name is Carrie Ray, and I'd like to thank everybody for coming out here this evening and our host, the association. By a brief introduction, my husband and I moved here in 2008, so I am a newbie, and I work for the BC Corrections Branch. I have done so for 27 years. 23 of those years have been in a management role. Why am I running for council? Council has a huge, the decisions made by council have a huge impact on our daily lives, and I think I have the experience and the skill to help make good decisions for each and every one of you here tonight and in the community as a whole. What will I bring to council? I'll bring leadership. It's about walking the talk. If I say I'll do something, I'll do it. If I can't do it, I'll let you know why. Leadership is about ensuring fairness. It's about making tough decisions, and I'll do my homework. I'll make sure that I listen to both sides of the story. And maybe at the end of the day, I might not support your position, but I will have looked at both sides and made a decision that I feel is best for Souk and the people of Souk. effective communication. I believe that success in business and organization is key to communication. It's about two ways. It's about listening to what people have to say, and it's about sharing information. So we keep everybody in the loop. And I think it's also important to recognize the voice for the residents of Sooke at the CRD level. It's a bigger piece, and to ensure efficiencies at the CRD level, Sooke has to have a voice for the people here. Respectful problem solving. Not everyone always agrees, and not everyone should feel that they have to agree. But what I'll bring to council is a respectful environment and not make it personal. I'm a forward thinker. It's not about Sooke today. It's about Sooke for your family in the future. I support the official community plan. It's been developed in consultation with the community and provides a vision for the future.
Thank you, Ms. Ray.
Hi, I'm Sean Salzburn. I'd like to just point out 2 minutes can go by very quickly, so everybody's got literature on the table. If your questions don't get answered, get them answered, call us, let us know what you'd like in Sooke. I'd like to thank everyone for coming and the Sooke Community Development Association for putting this on for us. I'd like to start out by saying that Sooke is a young municipality, and we can really be at the forefront in the way we invest in our youth, our seniors, and our environment. What is sustainable growth? Is it a political tool or a coin phrase brought out during election time? To me, it is a way of thinking and behaving, and what should motivate us in investing in new infrastructure and bringing in new development. We have seen plenty of new development, higher taxes, and still no sidewalks to stand on. So fiscal restraint will be very important. By keeping in mind our community needs, wants, and safety, and the environment impact we will have, we should work with our development community, community groups, and local businesses on projects that will benefit all of Sooke people. Growth is inevitable. And without it, our community will suffer. Investing in a sustainable community is an investment in ourselves and in our future generation. I can promise that I will keep listening and keep an open mind for everyone. Thank you.
Ms. Salzman, thank you very much. Ms. Tate, please.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. My name is Maya Tate. And I'm running for re-election because I believe that over the past 3 years, I've worked very hard to build relationships within this community. Relationships that are diverse, that cross cultural barriers, social barriers, and even political ones. I feel these relationships have given me insight into the concerns of our residents and into the challenges that lie ahead. I've done my best to represent this community in a respectful manner, to get along with other council members, and to work respectfully with staff. I give thoughtful consideration to every matter that comes across the agenda, and I feel every matter should stand on its own merit and benefit both the present as well as future generations. In my professional life, I run the building maintenance division for a property management company. I look after 8 buildings in 3 municipalities, as well as an office tower downtown. It's about 1,000 rental units in total. Through this experience, I'm well aware that the economy is shrinking, regulations are tightening, and individual needs are constantly changing. I feel that Council's role is to recognize these challenges, to work with organizations like the Sooke Builders Association, and to find ways that provide opportunities for locals that also create an environment that attracts grants, investment, and funding from other levels of government. It's been a challenge at times to balance the demands of both the professional and counselor life. You throw in family, personal obligations, and volunteer commitments. It doesn't leave a lot of time. However, overall, I found this to be a very rewarding experience. I'm grateful for the opportunity, And moreover, I've developed a very deep appreciation for the residents of this community and its long history. Going forward with the experience that I've obtained from both the committee work at both council and at the CRD level, I intend to work not only harder, but more effectively and to continue building these relationships and to embrace challenges as they arise. I consider council to be a team that works hard and plays well together and moves towards a shared vision.
Thank you.
Thank you for attending.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've heard from our presenters, and it's appropriate at this time for you who have formulated your questions of the individual candidates to please stand up, identify yourself, and if you'd be kind enough to direct your comments through the chair to the candidate, I would appreciate that. And let's try to keep our observations to questions rather than commentary. So please, somebody who's prepared to step up.
Mr. Chairman,
yes,
thank
sir.
You. My name is David Mallett, and I'd like to, my question is directed to Dave Bennett. Current mayor and council have made a number of major improvements for our town, including the new hotel, which is attracting numerous conventions and providing local jobs, the boat launch, new sidewalks on many of our streets, new Shoppers Drug Mart, improvements to Evergreen Mall, which will soon result in our doctors being all in one clinic, and much more like the support for Air Manners, seniors, residents, and care facility.
Do you have a question, Mr. Ballard?
Yes, this is a question to Dave Bennett. If you are elected mayor, how will you build on the good work of previous councils when setting priorities for the next 3 years?
Mr. Bennett.
Thank you. As has been suggested by a number of the candidates, the town has made tremendous progress in the past 3 years, and people have acknowledged to me the progress they have seen in the town and the fact that there are a number of local people working on some of these bigger projects. And I would work with staff and with council and with the various committees that support council and staff in their work to look at the long term and to continue working with some of these projects to see them through and hopefully attract other projects and to focus as well on our eco and cultural tourism, again, to build up more employment in our town. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Questions? Ms. Wallace?
I have a question for Mr. Bennett and Mr. Milne. I'll start with Mr. Bennett. If you're successful in becoming the new mayor of Sooke, with all the turmoil in the press and the distrust with the people of Sooke, will you be willing to have a full fiscal and performance audit done at the district?
Mr. Bennett.
I'm not sure if that question actually came from the Municipal Auditor General's office. We were told at UBCM that the provincial government will be bringing in a Municipal Auditor General, and that will allow for exactly the kind of thing that you are asking for if it is deemed necessary. I have full confidence in our staff. I am a taxpayer in this town as well. The budget process is open to the public. The public is welcome to attend those meetings in the chamber, and they are welcome to ask questions of staff. The staff are always available. The telephone number is known. The district website is known. People can ask questions. They can get answers.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Ms. Wallace, a second.
Same question.
I'm not sure it's appropriate to suggest at this time that you would discuss or would embark on a full financial audit. I mean, what a new council has to do, first of all, you should be looking forward, not backward. Secondly, if there are issues that come to our attention that are compared to, if I was in there, it would come to the attention of council that were suspicious or of concern, yes, you would look at them. But I don't think a new council should go in there with the idea of looking at everything the old council has done. It incurs a lot of expense. Those people were elected to do a job, and unless there's some specific issue, I don't think it would be a wise thing to do.
Thank you, Mr. Mill. Ladies and gentlemen, we have these candidates who are just really, really anxious to hear from you.
I'm Stuart Cumming. I'd like to ask all of the candidates one sentence answer. to, with their shrinking economy, how are they going to cover our taxes and keep hiring people like they've been doing? Thank you.
Candidates with a shortage of questions and obviously some time on our hands, perhaps we could just go down the table as we've done previously. Mr. Bennett?
15 communities across British Columbia have been compared, and of those 15, we are one of them. Our residential tax rate in 2010 was the second lowest. Our business tax rate in those 15 communities was the third lowest. I am a taxpayer in this community. I will be a steward of those public funds on your behalf.
Thank you, Mr.
I would like to say that we have been a very lean staff. We've kept our staff lean. They work very, very hard. I'm very proud of them. And we don't have anybody extra that we are taking on. And we haven't had extra people coming on to the district of Sioux for some time. And I'm really proud of, I have to say, that they are a wonderful staff and they work as hard as possible. And I think they do a very, very good job.
Thank you. I'm sorry, Ms. Beach. Ms. Berger?
It's a very big question. as far as fiscal responsibility goes, that's always been a key point of mine. I'm a certified bookkeeper, so I've also put a lot of my 3 years into the budget, and I've gone through the budget 1,000 different ways. I'd like to stand here and say I've supported every single budget we've had. I haven't, and I can't say that because I have, in fact, voted against our budgets in the past. I think there's room for fiscal improvement, and I think with the next council, we need to look at the fact that the economic downturn is still upon us. So we have to keep that in the back of our mind when going through our budgets and look for ways to tighten them.
Thank you, Ms. Mr. Colbert.
Respectfully, I'll keep asking questions until I get the answers that equal 1 plus 1 equals 2.
Thank you, Mr. Colbert. Mr. Dumas.
Well, I've been on the budget committee for 9 years. Been taking part in the community for 12 years, and I think that the district has worked very hard to keep their budget down. One of the things that's hurt a little bit is it's become union and we don't have the control that we had before, but we don't have any unnecessary people there, and I think if some of the people here were to go and try some of those jobs to find out how hard those people are working. Very surprised.
Thank you, Mr. Dumont. Mr. Calder.
Civic Info BC, they give all the stats on employees, on everything for communities all over British Columbia. Communities of BC for 10,000 people or less, we have the highest paid CEO by more than $10,000 for any community for 10,000 people or less, the average being $123,000 our CEO. CAO makes $150,000. We're always being told that Souk is the second or third lowest taxes in the district. That's not true at all. It's just an accounting error. What they do is they take out the fact that we pay sewer separately, water separately, and garbage separately. If you add all that in, we're the third highest in the CRD, 13 municipalities. So if Souk is this little town and we have no sidewalks, we have nothing to offer other than the fact that, you know, we've got some infrastructure that was put in years ago by volunteers in the community, association. We have to change things in this town. We have to make it so we can actually legitimately be third lowest in the CRD. And we're not going to do this by mixing numbers around. We're going to have to do it by actually taking responsibility for what we've done.
Thank you, Mr. Holding. Mr. Castro.
Well, when I was on council between 2005 2008, I chaired the Finance Committee. And it was a true working finance committee. Public input was sought. Every single contract that was let by the district was publicly reviewed by that committee with public input and public scrutiny. There were never any backroom deals done in any contracts that were awarded during our tenure. I don't know what's happened in the past 3 years, but it's got to stop. Over $6 million in untendered contracts have been let by this council, and that's wrong. That's an insult to you as taxpayers. If there was a 10% reduction in those contracts, That's $600,000 over the next 5 years. That money can go a long way. So what I advocate is better value for your tax dollar. Get a true working finance committee with some public input at every step of the way. No more backroom negotiations, no more backroom deals, and get public scrutiny in everything that's done at this council. That's got to change. That has to happen because we're in serious trouble. Thank you.
That's an excellent question. It is a two-part question in which you've got internal spending and external spending, so there's two different areas you'd look at. In terms of the external spending, Mr. Casper's nailed it. As a project manager, I have never seen so much sole sourcing done anywhere. There's no reason for it. It's against district policy. And the only reason you would do that is if you only have one vendor that you could possibly get it from. You don't have any other choice. Other than that, it needs to be tendered out, and the tendering process needs to be managed properly, which it isn't right now. The other area of external spending comes in the financial statements. You can go through, and this is any business faces this, if you need to cut your budget, you go through your financial statement, you go line by line through that thing and find out what you're going to cut out, and you take the number off. It hurts a lot of times, but if the bottom line has to change, then the only way to do it is cut it. That's what you do. There are areas in there that we can cut without getting necessarily impacting the service levels and that type of thing, and that comes in the CRD requisition. Most people don't even look at it, but there again, everything that the district spends on that goes to the CRD is a service that we buy from the CRD, and there's a provision in the Local Government Act for service review, and we can renegotiate those services. And a good example of that is the parks acquisition. It was foisted on us. Souk didn't want it. Souk said they didn't want it. They voted against it, and yet here we have it, and it's increasing. They doubled it and tripled it. It's up to $20 or something, $4. Same thing with the entire parks thing. We're spending over $200,000 a year on parks, and we can't put a lawn in the Gregor Park. We don't have to do that. We can put the lawn there and not give them the money. And that process is there. In terms of the internal one, the staff performance measures are a standard procedure for getting control of the project. If you've got people that aren't working, you can't figure out why you're spending so much money on wages and you're not getting anything done. There are ways of controlling and measuring staff performance and correcting it. Case. The last thing that you really want to do is have to replace them, because they're very expensive to do. But you do need to motivate the property, and you do need to get the performance from them.
Boy, these are long sentences.
Yeah, really.
Mr. Milne, so I'm going to take advantage of that.
I didn't mean
but you know, in all seriousness, we live in a bubble here. The world is in trouble. Watch the news. Watch what's going on in the States. Watch what's going on in Europe. Talk to the builders. Talk to the realtors. Predicting we're going to have 4% growth over the next 2 or 3 years is ridiculous. There isn't going to be 4% growth. So to answer your question specifically, Mr. Cummings, in the budget they've allotted approximately $500,000 in the next 5 years to increase staff by 8 people, give some raises and whatnot. We don't need to increase staff if we're not growing. We need to do things better. We need to do things the old adage, do it better, do it more efficiently. Nobody else in the world right now is getting raises. A lot of people are getting rolled back. Provincial, federal governments are not getting raises, so I don't see raises in the card for anybody for 2 or 3 years. So there's $500,000. You look at conferences and travel, another $500,000 over the next 5 years. And I would like to point out that our taxes on the growth side of things, yes, we're the lowest, but our houses are also assessed at a low value compared to the other municipalities. So if you look at our assessed value on the mill rate on a per $100,000 assessment, we're the third highest. We're behind Esquimalt and Victoria. Just because we have cheaper houses, our taxes are lower. So when I look through the budget, I find lots of areas, and I'm not talking about cutting, I'm talking about getting a level that's sustainable. Let's keep it at 0 or 1% or somewhere around that for a few years. People could stomach that, but they can't stomach the 4 and the 5 and the 6. Like in year 2014, they've got a 6.9 or a 7% tax increase. That is not on for people that are working for a living, people that are receiving pensions. It's just not on. We've got to do something. And it's there to do, I believe, with careful spending and really looking at what the budget lines are.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Mitchell.
Thank you. Answer to your question there, to try and get the finances in line and reduce the property taxes. We just have to have an open mind here and look at everything we're spending money on now and try and see how can we reduce it. Do we really need to spend that? One example for you is in the 2011 budget. There's $23,000 allocated to replace the outside lights at City Hall. And the first question you'd ask is, why do we need to replace lights that are already working in these economic times? I've happened to find out what the bill was for those lights. It's $28,000, a little over that. So we're already $5,000 over budget. That doesn't count. They've been working on it for 2 months. There's concrete work, there's electrician, there's other materials, excavation work. I'm sure that bill is going to be over $50,000. And that's where, in the past, there hasn't been any regulation on budgets. Council has just gone madly on spending money. There are already $700,000 spent on the 2012 budget. So just look at where the taxes are going to go. Does that answer your question?
Hold on, a numbers guy on a question like that. But it comes down to fiscal responsibility. You have to look at those contracts. You have to put them out to the appropriate bidders and make sure that that process is fair for the external. For the internal, you have to look at your staffing. What can we do better? This is my other life as the ops manager for the large federal company that I work for. You have to set expectations of productivity with the employees that are there. You have to look at what they're doing, and is there value in what they're doing? You know, I mean, Steve Swartz will probably be mad at me, but can the fire truck guy, can he go cut the grass? I mean, you can do more than one function. You don't have to stick into your job descriptions and things like that. So you have to be creative, and you have to set expectations, and you have to measure those expectations.
Thank you, Mr. Pierce.
Municipal overspending is an issue across the province of British Columbia. This is, and I believe that responsible and accountable spending, there's a big difference between what we need as a community and what we want as a community. And I believe that you have to put your priorities in terms of what people need when you make those decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ray.
Thank you, Stuart. Very important question, and thank you for that question. Federal and provincial governments are cutting their budgets considerably, and the municipalities get hurt, incredibly hurt, by all the cuts that come from above. So it's very important that we spend every dollar very cautiously and invest in things that we do want, you know, and put our priorities straight. And I think we can sum that up in fiscal restraint is the good two words that we can sum that question up in.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Cummings. Creativity, communication, and a sharp pencil. The council has held many district open houses, newsletters, and they're now tweeting to get the message out. What we need to know is what's happening. Why is there a disconnect between the public and council? If you're upset with the taxes, why are we not hearing? Why is the chamber empty when we're talking about the budget? What can we do to encourage you to attend? If council sets a strategic plan, and if you're not comfortable with the items on the plan, you need to communicate that. But afterwards, after you get your notice saying, oh, well, it's done, right? So I think what needs to happen is we need to repair this relationship so that you feel that your concerns are heard and that the needs of the community are addressed, because then that can all go into a budget. We can put it forward, but it's important to engage you, and it's important that you attend and give us that feedback. Thank you.
My name is Mark Zinger, and I'm a resident of Sioux.
Yes, Mr. Zinger.
For Mr. Bill, first, Mr. Bennett, the same question. I realize that in our official community plan, we have transportation alternative routes. We're trying to relieve congestion in the downtown core along the Sioux River Road, but the change seems to be very slow, and certainly the congestion is increasing faster. And I'm just wondering how much of a priority relieving congestion in the downtown core of Sioux is for each of you.
It's a real priority, and there's two reasons for that. One is the congestion. The other reason is the downtown core, Highway 14, is controlled by the Ministry of Highways, so that really restricts what the municipality can do with relation to beautification and accessibility. Part of the, my understanding, part of the demand that Highways has to give up some of the control is to have a bypass, and credit to council, they put aside some money, and I understand they're prepared to start working on the bypass, which will come by the arena and end up joining with Throop Road. A eventually coming across to join Grant Road. For me, it's a priority. We need the bypass to relieve congestion. We need the bypass to get control of our downtown core, because we've got to build from the heart out. If you don't have a heart in a community, you've got nothing, and so we've got to do that. It is important.
Thank you, Mr. Ziegler. The district has a memorandum of understanding with the Ministry of Transport, and so we're very fortunate to be able to work with them. And there is regular consultation with ministry staff and our district staff. We had the opportunity, as Mr. Mill mentioned, to beautify our downtown area a few years back, and that referendum was defeated through the AAP process, so we had to give a check back to the ministry. To relieve congestion in the downtown area, as mentioned, with a provincial highway running through the downtown is a long and difficult process, but we continue to work with MOT on that. And with the connector road, a priority of council, and hopefully with the next council, progress would be seen, hopefully by the end of this year, early spring, on that connector road starting. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett.
To shout from here.
As you wish.
I'm Laurie Savoie. I've lived here for 7 years. Mr. Chair, could I have this question go right down the list of
Go ahead.
Many of you have mentioned the need for attracting business jobs in Souk rather than keeping us a bedroom community. Can you all mention briefly what sort of businesses, what sort of jobs you would be going out to bring into Souk?
Candidates, what's your wish? Table end to end?
Sounds good.
Thank you.
I would continue to focus on eco and cultural tourism as one of the key industries that we can attract to this town and build on in this town. We already have a tremendous number of businesses that focus on that. There is increased effort to promote the Pacific Marine Circle Route, which draws people from around the world, and again, focusing on our hospitality industry. The Subaru Triathlon was brought to Souk a number of years ago and was on TSN. And again, that has gone worldwide. I would hope that we could also attract industries such as the one in the Kaltasin workyard area, the HBM Industries, which is making solar lights and so on that are being used around the world. So light industry, tech industry, assembly industry, that can be a home base or a small light industry process.
I know at this time, and for some time, we have been looking at getting a business park in Souk. It's going to take a while. We have people who want to build up it on the land, but the land is partially or maybe all on ALR land.
Sorry, I've lost you. I know there is a business park up there. You mean it's not usable?
No, we don't have a business park. As of yet, which one are you thinking? Are you thinking of?
Through the chair. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Isn't there a business park up Otter Point Road? There's a big sign.
Miss Beach is answering your question.
No, you asked me.
I understand that.
Okay, I'm unclear. I'm lost.
Okay, if you'd like to clarify your question to the candidate,
I'll stand
we can
up
forward.
I believe that business park is not in Souk. It's just on the edge of Souk, from my understanding, but we are wanting to have one right in the core, and that is a dream, and we're hoping very much that we're going to be able to get that happening along with the way.
Thank you. I'm going to start by a quick little caption. I attended a seminar in Vancouver at UBCM, and it was on economic downturn and how we can turn our communities around, and one sentence stuck with me, and it said, boast your place-based assets, but that'll only take you so far. So I enjoyed that statement because we live in a beautiful place and we have lots of place-based assets. Tourism is obviously part of it, but it will only take us so far. So for me, what I'd like to see is I'd like to see some sort of post-secondary education, maybe a small satellite here in Souk. I'd also like to see maybe satellite offices from downtown to alleviate congestion and keep people working here in town. So for me, it's about generating some new business and trying to get that happening because our place-based assets will only take us so far.
Thank you, Mr. Mr. Coburn.
I think this one is of ultimate importance. I think it's one of the biggest reasons why everybody's here tonight. You know, I think that the commercial aspect of souk is what will alleviate tax burden from the residential side of it. And we all know that, we all feel that that's where it's supposed to come from. Okay, there's a lot of talk in the world, and especially in Canada right now, about that. I think that the things that we need to do to promote businesses to come are what council is doing. It's pushing, the TCP, the town core plan, pushing for it, increased densities in the town core. Okay, if we can think in, not just this year or next year, but let's think in 10 years, okay? What do we want our town core to be like? We want it to be commercial with residential. We want it to be a nice, comfortable place to be where you can comfortably walk around and enjoy and find whatever you want and be able to offer whatever you want to offer out to a public, a numbered public. That's
thank you, Mr. Colbert.
Well, everybody's mentioned all kinds of things, and one of the things, and because of the specific groups is putting on, we've given up probably 4 contracts in the community because we don't have a contractor in the District of Sioux that is a full contractor and can take on a big job like Mariner's Village or the hotel or any of the big ones. We don't have people that group together and put in a bid. We've all talked about that we should be getting bids on things, but we need this association to get themselves some people together where they can put in bids and get some of the work. I see lots of people working in Sioux, and most of it is from outside the communities. We need to cooperate with each other if we want to do that type of thing. And it's going to be more and more in Sioux of those big buildings. If we're going to do the downtown core, we need contractors that can put in a bid. And right now, we're all working as individuals, and you can't get those big bids. The other thing that I would like to see and hope it would develop is our light industrial areas. We've talked about tech and things like that. Well, with all the facilities we got now for these phones and you can do it from anywhere. You can do it from the top of the mountain. So if we can establish it in Sioux, we can do it in Sioux. But it's something you've got to want. You can't just expect it to come on itself. And that's the hard part, putting your head down. The people that built this, the community association, they didn't look around and say, what can we do? They went and did it. And I think that if we want something, we're going to have to do it. If we want commerce here, we got to work at it. It isn't going to come to us on our own.
Thank you, Mr. Dumas. Mr. Halder.
I attended UBCM, which is a conference for all municipalities. Devin, Maya, and myself, we did that a few weeks ago. And in the conference, they were telling us about what expectations should be in your areas. And we live in an area which is the third most expensive place in the country to live. And costs are too high for a lot of things. But they did say one thing. They said Victoria itself, if you take Canada as a whole, Victoria, out of all the people who want to retire in this country, 17% of them want to come to Victoria. 11% want to go to Kelowna, 6% to Vancouver, 6% to Toronto. So this area here is the golden egg for everybody to want to come here. And 17% doesn't sound like a lot probably, but in the big picture of 35 million Canadians, this is the place where everybody wants to come. I'm not going to lie to you and tell you that we're going to get mills and mines and fishing back up and run it again. I'd love to see something on that level happen to a degree, but I don't believe it's possible. I mean, families can't afford to come here and spend the money on the houses like they did way back in the day. So what we have to do is we have to set up business based on the fact that we're going to get 17% of the population of this country coming here to retire, or 17% of retired population coming here. So that's what we have to do. It's about building a quality of life. It's about building facilities that the older generation is looking for. I mean, they want to come here because of our weather, our fishing, the mountains, the fresh air, and all this stuff. So that's where our industry has to derive from. We can't fool ourselves into thinking that this is going to be this industrial town that it once was 30 or 40 years ago. And they told us to stop thinking on those levels. So we have a CRD here that has a regional growth strategy set up to build these bike trails, to buy all this parkland, do all this stuff. We have very little control over that, but it's happening around us, and that's what's going to keep happening. So I would tell you that I'm I would plan for a retirement community here because families can't afford to move here, so we're going to have to start planning on the fact that the retirees and the more affluent are going to be moving to this place.
Thank you, Mr. Haldane. Mr. Casper.
Well, you've got to start thinking outside the box. When I was on council, I was an original signatory on the letter that invited the owners of Prestige to come to Souk, gave them a tour, and encouraged them and other hoteliers to look at opportunities in this community. But I think it boils down to how our administration in the municipality is thinking. And it's this: why can't they change the way they do business to accommodate Souk businesses? They're not listening to Souk businesses, to their needs and wants. Maybe the priority should be this: not a dime of taxpayers' dollars is going to be spent unless you hire Souk businesses. It's that simple. And then those businesses can get together, whether they form a new company, whether they arrange agreements between themselves, but the priority should be this: if it's Souk tax dollars, it hires Souk people, Souk businesses, otherwise you don't get the job done. I'm tired of seeing outsiders come into this town while our own people aren't working, and that's got to change.
Well, I am, Mr. Martin. Yeah, I am a businessman. I've been self-employed for 30 years, and I'm also from a small town. And I can tell you the biggest problem facing any business in any small town is we have a guy. If you want to do business here, that's the answer you're going to get. It's extraordinarily difficult to start a business. What the municipality can do is they have access to market data, and that's probably the most important thing that anybody looking at Souk needs. They need a market analysis. Whatever the sector may be, whatever sector, pick one. There's this much money in the economy here. There's how much is being spent. Maybe it's $1 million. You can expect to take 1%, 10%, whatever it is, and they can very quickly get to the point of whether it's worth putting a business here or not. Those numbers are available through the tax data, all sorts of things that go on that the governments collect data on. And as far as I know, that's not available in Souk. Everybody that comes here has to do their own work on that. It's an extremely difficult and expensive process. There is a process that's actually currently running in Souk, and probably nobody's ever even heard about it unless you're from the arts community, and that's the cultural planning process. That's the one thing that Souk has, and it fits, it hits everything, and that is why people come to Souk. Culture is a commodity. It's sold. You can put it in a box and you can sell it. Art is one way to do that, but that's not by any means the only way. And there are a number of areas that have been extremely successful in marketing their culture. Alert Bay is a good example. First Nations culture there. You go to Alert Bay, that's what you're buying. You're buying their culture. You go to the store. Any place you spend money, you're buying their culture. Sector-wise, I'm positioned in recreation and leisure. I've got an interest in that. I think, as Mr. Haldane has said, that's what people are coming here for. I happen to like that one. Education's another one. And a lot of this type of thing you can do long distance education type of thing. Takes technology and those types of things. Technology itself is not going to come here. It's simply, there's no reason for technology to be here. We have about $1.5 billion economy in Saanich. It's close to universities. All of the market is already soaked up there, and there's no reason for technology as a sector to move to Souk. But technology is available to Souk to be used in the pursuit of business, and distance education, those types of things are good examples of that.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Mr. Miller.
So affordability is a big issue, and I think vision is equally as important. So a tourist is going to come out here, take advantage of our ecotourism or our arts community, and they drive through Souk and they say, what is this place? Why would I want to stop here? So the council has to have a vision. They have to show some initiative. And they have to quit doing studies, and they have to say, let's take a block and let's do something with it, and let's work with the Department of Highways. And it's obviously doable. If you go to View Royal and you go to the casino area, you'll see that they've made some nice sidewalks, some green space, some lights. It's starting to look nice. We've got to do that here. We want to attract people to come here, and the reality is we're going to be looking at the service industry that may support retirement communities or the tourism. I don't think we're going to attract any heavy industry. Obviously, we don't have a space for it, and as far as the technology, we're not going to get that. But we've got to make it easy and inviting for people. And the only way you do that is build a place that's inviting and people want to come to. Because if you don't do that, they're not even going to stop. They're just going to whiz through Souk on their way on the circle route and say, nice seeing you. They might stop at the grocery store to get some ice or some milk, but that'll be it. So block by block, we've got to start doing something right now.
Thank you, Mr. Bill. Mr. Mitchell.
Well, my thought is if we can get the property taxes down, we can attract a lot of people and businesses to come to Sooke. I've been involved in the Chamber of Commerce for a number of years. I've been in Sooke for 35 years. There's been lots of money spent on different schemes and plans and everything. Nothing really seems to work. The reality is that we've only got a limited population, and it's not going to support a lot of business. There's nothing wrong with us being a bedroom community to Victoria. But let's just make ourselves the best bedroom community in North America. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Pearson.
Well, businesses will come for one reason, money. It's either how much they have to spend and eventually how much they're going to earn. And that comes down to the affordability of the property that they're going to buy to set up their businesses, and then what's that foot traffic when they're there. So if we start building affordable houses and we get the population and people, like Herb says, want to retire here, well then people come and the businesses will follow. But the council and the district has to get out of the way of the people who want to set up those businesses. You don't make it cumbersome, you don't make it time consuming, because they also will have a timeline when they want return on their investment. So again, it's about the ease of doing business.
Thank you, Mr. Pearson. Ms. Ray.
Yes, thank you. Commercial and industrial business really is the growth in terms of supporting our tax base. And I'm not an expert at business and marketing, but I think that there needs to be a dialogue between council and the Chamber of Commerce and the business community. You are the ones that have already set up businesses here. You are the ones that are doing business here. And so help us in a consultative way look at where the gaps are and what the challenges are. And so I think consult locally with the experts in our community to get a vision to move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Salzman. Ms. T.
Thank you, Laurie. Again, another important question. They all are. I'd like to see a lot of marine science being brought into Sooke, that there's a big industry for marine science. I'd like to see us support our agricultural sectors and green business sectors as well. I think we've been here 10 years, and I'd love to have an industrial piece of property for my husband to set up shop and create jobs here, but there is a lot of red tape and it's very expensive. We need to start supporting small businesses, and I think that's an answer that we can all get behind.
Thank you, Ms. Savoie, for your question. There's a few things. The natural abundance here attracts year-round recreation. And then as a result, we have both seniors and young families alike moving into the area. So part of this involves community-based tourism, items like the Sooke Fine Art Show, the recent slow food cycle, and other matters that get people out enjoying what we have here, things like the triathlon and so on. Sooke once played host to the logging exhibition that attracted almost 15,000 people to this town. And so it's finding other initiatives like that draw people out. In addition to that, we had a presentation recently from the Sooke School District that showed that as soon as 2014, the demand for spaces in schools is going to, we're out of room because of full day kindergarten and the families that now live here. Health and education is an important part of that. So we need to work with the province and other levels of government so they can get the schools built and the health services that we need, and that'll put other local people to work. In my own neighborhood, there's 15 families. We all moved in at the same time. Everyone commuted into Victoria. More than half of them now all have work in Sooke, and it's all based in health and education. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Next question.
Yes or no question, so it should go quickly. Prestige Hotel Conference Center agreement costs the District of Sooke $821 a day for a conference center that sits empty. From the mayor's chair or council chair, would you support such an agreement today without giving the public a voice? And that can go all the way down.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. I'm not sure if I can give you a yes or no. I haven't done all the financial on it to look at those numbers for my own self, but if I had to spend, if I base it all on that and it's $800 a day for something to sit empty, probably not.
It's $821 a day.
I'm going to have to answer it hypothetically only because I haven't done the numerical responsibility myself.
I see the benefit.
At this hall, we don't have those confirmation of those figures, and we're relying on your information, so please allow the candidate to speak. Thank
I have you. To take this hypothetical, sorry.
Mr. Colbert.
Yes.
Yes.
No.
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 No. The whole deal was a scam on the public.
No.
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 With community consultation, yes. Without, no.
You have your answers. Please step forward, sir.
Robert Donald Smith. I have a question for Mr. Martin and for Mr. Haldane. I noticed quite an increase in the fire department taxes last year, and I want to know how much they increased, and I want to know why. Thank you.
I believe he's referring to Mr. Bennett. Was your question for Mr. Martin or for Mr. Bennett, sir?
Mr. Martin and for Mr. Haldane.
Excuse me, sir. This is Mr. Martin.
Mr. Bennett, sorry.
I'll answer
I'm retarded, okay? Leave me alone. The guy on the end and that sucker.
It's cultural.
Got it. Good.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. We need a little levity here. It's starting to get serious. All right, Mr. Martin Bennett, please.
I'm not sure I'm speaking on Mr. Martin's behalf. As you are probably very well aware, Sioux Fire Rescue Service has salaried staff members as well as a volunteer fire department. And part of that tax increase would be going toward paying for those salaries so that we had a guaranteed call out of at least two members for each fire call out 24 hours a day. And it also has gone towards the long-term financing of equipment acquisition.
No, hold it.
No, I answered your question.
Excuse me.
It says
Excuse
how
me,
much?
Mr. Smith.
Excuse me, I said how much and why. You got the why. I want to know how much.
Well, I don't have the fire department taxes right here in front of me. Perhaps I could find those out for you and I could let you know at the next all candidates meeting.
Because it had to go through you guys to get that.
I don't
Thank
have
you
the
very much for your question,
me.
Sir. Thank you.
Well, I'm not positive to the how much either. I do know it was increased quite substantially, but the why is because the same reason why we have seven staff members who make more than $90,000 a year in the senior staff levels, our fire chief being one of them. But the problem here is it's a want. We have a council when staff comes forward or our budget comes forward, everybody has these wants. We rubber stamp, we pass it through, everybody gets whatever everybody wants. We bought fire trucks this year that we didn't need. We've got staff members we don't need. I'll give you an example. We've got Langford who's got eight full-time or paid staff members. Sioux's got seven. Langford's got 25,000 people. Langford's got a budget that's three times what ours is, but we've got one less fireman than Langford does. We have a volunteer staff that's been around this town here, I would guess, for 70 years, 80 years. The problem here is we don't. Our fire chief, for some reason, doesn't trust the volunteer staff to be able to come out every day and do a good job, so he keeps complaining that we don't have enough people, so we hire more and more and more, so we can have all these people on during the day. In places like Langford, I talked to Stu Young about that, and what he does is he has eight full-time people, but he also has those guys. They go around, they water the plants, they look after some of the gardening issues, they take care of some of the road works. And they do all that stuff because that way he can make it affordable for Langford taxpayers, and that's why Langford has the lowest taxes in the entire CRD, because they take care of their budget properly, and they make sure everybody has something to do and something ongoing, and they do it on a need basis, not on a want basis.
Thank you, Mr. Holding.
Thank you.
Questions?
My name's Ann Fredette. I do live in Sooke. I've been here about a year and a half. My question is regarding the smart meters. Smart meters, there's a lot of things that came out about smart meters, and there's a lot of concerns about them. And this I'm going to address to the two candidates running for mayor. A lot of communities, because of the carcinogenic problems with them, have came out with a stand not in our municipality until after the bugs are all worked out. Would you be prepared as a mayor to set that platform here?
Questions to the mayoralty candidates, Mr. Bennett.
I did a lot of research into smart meters, and I received a number of very personal emails from a number of Sooke residents, and I communicated back to them. When I was at UBCM, I listened to all of the deliberations on the smart meter issue, and I was part of a vote that very narrowly requested that BC Hydro, the Utilities Commission, the various ministers responsible for the different areas, have a moratorium on smart meters until adequate research, third-party, research, whatever, can be carried out. Shortly after that moratorium vote was announced, Minister Coleman said, well, that's too bad, we're going ahead anyway. So I was prepared to have a moratorium. I was prepared to support a moratorium for smart meters in British Columbia, given the various concerns that I had heard from my constituents and what I heard at UBCM.
I too would support a moratorium. I think the reality of the smart meters are a grab for BC Hydro. They'll have a better handle on what's going on, and they'll be able to tax us accordingly with our hydro bills because they'll know what we're using. So I support it for that reason. And the second reason, they still don't know really whether they are going to create problems or harm, so I think it should be put on hold.
Thank you.
Could I add to that?
Supplemental.
Because smart meters are not mandatory, would you be part of a process to let the community members in Sooke know that they can post and not have them put on?
Okay, I think we're getting into an area that, because it's a municipal issue, it's very difficult to enforce it at the local government level. But in returning emails to different constituents or talking to them, I communicated the fact that they should be expressing their health concerns or concerns that they have about smart meters with regard to health issues in particular to the Minister of Health as well as to the Utilities Commission and to BC Hydro. I also said that as an ordinary citizen, they had the right to refuse that installation. Well, BC Hydro has another view, but that's what I recommended to them.
I see nothing the matter with putting some sort of information out to the community through the newspaper or whatever, alerting to the fact they have that right, because people depend on government to give them information, and by the time you weed through it, it's very difficult, so I think we have an obligation to keep them informed.
Excellent. Thank you. Yes?
Hi, Deb Johnston, and I have a question for every one of the candidates wanting to know what one character trait or a personality trait you possess that would make you a very good candidate for a healthy, functional council. Maybe starting at this end for a change.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Johnston. One character trait? Patience.
Thank you.
I'd like to say honesty. I think we need more of that.
Leadership.
Focus. I would come prepared, and my background is an accountant, and I just happen to have the budget for me, Donnie, there, the retarded guy back there. And your fire budget for 2010 was $685,000, $820,000 for 2011, goes up to $1,030,000 by 2015.
Thank you.
Understanding, and I just want to explain, I believe that everybody has some good points. You get two sides to an argument. I think everybody has some valid points. You can't always bring people to the center, but you can give each of them a little bit to go home with. And I think that's the success in coordinating and getting people together to work together. You've got to be able to understand that everybody has some good points, and you've got to stroke them so that everybody goes home a bit of a winner, not always the same amount.
Friendly and compassionate.
Can
I use one of the
I don't know if it's good or bad. I'm not afraid to speak out.
Let's tell you, I've got so many good qualities.
Well, tenacity.
Okay, tenacity.
spending 4.5 years with a little baby at my age, I can say patience.
Good listener.
Thanks.
Thank you, candidates.
Hi, my name is Margarita Dominguez. I live in Sioux. My question is for Bennett and for Sheila Beach. How can we be sure that you're not going to appoint members to committees who are in conflict of interest, as it happened in the Sioux program of the R committee, and that you're not going to shut us down with a lawyer when we prove you wrong?
Mr. Bennett, do you care to respond to that?
As most of you know, committee members to district committees are called for in the local press through advertisements asking for people to volunteer. They are also sort of kept in reserve in the event that a district committee is set up that may perhaps meet that particular person's area of interest. Then when district staff bring the committee applications to a council meeting where we decide on the membership for that committee, then every council member has an opportunity to look through those applications and to look into the background or whatever. And it is a council decision as to the appointments on those committees. And I would do my part to make an informed decision on all those members.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett, for the speech.
I have never, in the time that I've been on committees, had seen a conflict of interest, and there haven't been any on my watch. Thank you very much.
Come forward.
Can I speak from here, please?
Around the Kingston Center, let us all appreciate what's on your
toes. Watch your toes. My name is Michael Nikes, and I'm a small business owner here in Sooke and a resident for the past year and a half. A point that everyone had touched on at some point in time was the fact that there needs to be more public input, more integration of the public voice. And Maya touched on it a little bit as well. There's various methods that have been used in the past, but perhaps unsuccessfully. Maybe every second candidate could answer the question, what new forum can you provide for the public to speak?
Okay, so that I understand the question, it would help to sort of hear the answers. What new forum would you provide?
Would you be able to propose so that the public has a voice, perhaps in ways they haven't in the past?
Well, new forms of communication. I mean, if we want to start from the center, why don't we move from center to my right?
Well, it just takes an amendment to the procedural bylaw of the district and how it operates. And it can choose to get public input either at the beginning or the end, but it's got to be meaningful. Instead of restricting the time limits, which currently exist, and I know our council of the day was probably no better off than this one, because we were always told, oh, this is always the way it's done. Well, maybe that has to change. Just a better way of doing business, be a little more open and less condescending as to what the public truly has to say, because you're the ones who are paying the freight.
Well, I like this forum. I mean, we have council all the time, and Maya pointed out earlier that people don't always get out to a meeting or they can't always come out. And it's so stuffy in there, and there's so many rules that people don't get to say what they want anyway. So even if you came with this thing and you've got up enough courage to actually get up there, and you were coming to a council meeting, you get there and you're either shut down, there's not enough time left, or they moved on and you didn't know that your spot was right now because you're supposed to talk in public question and answer period. Bev, Maya, and myself had pushed forward to try and get more public speaking at the end of a council meeting, sort of an open mic system set up. And that was shut down by the rest of council and the mayor because they thought that it would take up too much time or people would come with insignificant stuff to talk about. I don't believe there is such thing as insignificant stuff to talk about. So in this case, I would like to see this sort of stuff happen where there's, you can pick up somebody out of the community. Adrian here builds houses, he's a developer and stuff. You can share a meeting, you can sit here and you can throw questions back and forth. It's a little more informal, but you get a little more honesty, a little more truth and straightforwardness, rather than some council meeting where there's all these procedural rules and stuff.
Thank you.
Well, I've been involved in almost every way you can do it. I actually took courses when I was on the CRD for communication. And if anybody's taken that, they find out how funny things can be. Charlie Perkins had community meetings that were good to start with, and pretty soon it was him and one other person, or him and three other people. When we started council, we started having a voice at the beginning and a voice at the end. Nobody wanted to stay till 11 o'clock to speak, so we took it off of there. We tried every single way. We had coffee meetings. We had meetings with the council. We had open meetings to meet them every Monday. Even the mayor to this day has them every Monday. It all fades away. It's hard to get people to communicate because they're all so busy. They're all trying to earn a living. All have things they have to do with their children and ever, and it's very difficult. Unless something really bugs you, very few people turn in. When we used to have the budget meetings, we had them in the evening, had them during the day, tried to pick up some people. We had no one come, absolutely no one. You sit there and talk to yourself. We tried everything, and I don't know what you do. Tried. What would make you come to a meeting?
He needs to talk at us.
That's my question. What would make you come to a meeting?
Thank you, Mr. Dumont. Mr. Colbert.
Well, the doors really are open. You know, the doors really are open. At the administrative building, absolutely. Okay, to walk in and to ask a question to somebody who's giving an answer to something, it's there, period. Okay, anybody who says it's not, they haven't tried hard enough in a nice, polite manner. Okay? Anything that's asked with dignity and respect in this community, to anybody, it's there. You know, I see that all the time. Okay? If you're not feeling that, it's ask for it again. If you really don't, you know, ask for it again, or ask another person to ask for it. Okay? Hey, ask me. Okay? I'll ask for anything. I'll talk about anything. You know, communication. Sometimes it needs just a little bit of clarity. You know, it's not hidden away. In-camera meetings, by the way, so everybody understands this. The in-camera meetings means in chambers. You know, that's the Latin equivalent of in chambers, in camera. So it's not that they're being filmed and that's, you know, it's being privatized that way. It's a very traditional form of government and what changes there. You know, coming back, the community that wants to know more about the community and how it runs has to go to the council meetings. That's where it's at. It's at the council committee of the whole and the regular meetings.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Colbert. Ms. Berger?
Thank you. I love that you asked this question. I love it so much, I dedicated the middle of my flyer to it. Community and public involvement. Herb has touched on it a little bit. On November 19th, 2010, I passed a notice of motion put forward to all of our council that we entertain an open mic situation. Everybody in Soup knows that we meet at council chambers every Monday. Keeping things regular and consistent will catch on. The trend will then catch on. So my motion was for once a month to dedicate anywhere from half an hour to 60 minutes per council meeting, just once a month, to a complete open mic. Anybody in the community, taxpayers, businesses, no matter who you are, if you had anything to come and talk about, we'd be there to listen for that half an hour or 30 minutes. Unfortunately, it was defeated on February 2nd, 2011. So I would love to see that happen again. If reelected, I would again put that motion forward once a month to allow everyone to come and talk about anything without any regulations, without following any rules. It would be regular, consistent, everyone would know that we're available to you once a month, every Monday.
Thank you. Ms. Peach.
The most successful
time, communication time that I have had the experience with has been when we have it in the community hall. And we have all our different agencies there to talk to anybody who wants to be there. We sometimes don't have as many people come as others, but this has been the most that we would have come. And it depends on what's going on in the town. If there's something special, then more people will come. And it's really quite festive. There's food, which is always a good, you know, thing to bring in when you're going to do that. But also people are meeting each other, and that's what I really like, is when we see each other, our neighbors, because it is very difficult for people to see your neighbors on a regular basis. And I find that there's a lot of engagement there. That, to me, for the 6 years that I've been on council, has been the most successful. And it is difficult. We've gone to the council chambers. It's been put out in the paper, come to whatever seems to be happening. And we all sit there and eat the cookies, and nobody comes. You know, you might be lucky if one does. And so it's disappointing, because I think that none of us touch each other enough in our town. I think that's growing a little bit more the more we're getting a town centered and developing and getting big. But it is disappointing. But it is easier for everybody, all of us, to be doing it at the same time, so that, because people are so busy, it's really hard to bring them together. So we do try, and honestly, our CAO, our corporate officer, works the buns off to try and get things to bring people in. So if you see that it's happening, come and just, you know, maybe you'll see a friend there or something, and you'll be able to engage with some of our staff.
Thank you for the speech.
Thank you. If I am elected mayor in the new year, I'll be self-publishing a book called The Mayor and His New Clothes. I will do anything to get more people informed. I will do anything to get more people involved. I will do anything to get more people knowing what's going on in their town. In the first year of my term, I brought forward the idea of coffee with council. I might even have sat with some of you during those council sessions on Saturday mornings. We made ourselves available on a rotating basis in the different coffee shops every Saturday morning to hear what your concerns were, what your questions were. By the end of the second year, there was a very strong rumor going around town that Miss Tate and Mr. Bennett were now Mr. and Mrs. Tate / Bennett. Because we were the only councillors supporting them. At a council meeting, a delegation can make a presentation. They can ask for input from council. Other members of the public can comment on that presentation made as a delegation. There are opportunities during the council meeting to provide input. I sat through the CRD tanning salon debate on behalf of this district from 1:30 until 6:30 p.m. on a day. There was lots of public input. At a committee of the whole evening, the emphasis is on discussion between the councillors and the public. And no item on a committee of the whole agenda goes without allowing for public input. And sometimes we plead for it. I have asked staff to communicate, and then I've asked them to keep communicating, and then I have asked them to communicate again. We have had open houses. The official community plan was unprecedented in the amount of public input that was requested, that was received, and that was acted on. We tweet. I think we even Facebook. We put out newsletters. We have a website. We have a telephone number. We have an incredibly friendly and helpful front desk. When I have questions that are asked of me, I give them the website, I give them the telephone number, I give them the people at the front desk to then channel that request if I can't provide them with the answer. And as candidate Ray just mentioned a few moments ago, if I don't have the answer, I will find it out. The opportunity is there. The people of Sioux need to take advantage of them.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bennett. Now,
A similar question?
Similar question.
Can I make a suggestion? I noticed, and I really wish I had the same appliance, but I noticed people cleaning their glasses and scratching their ears and things. I think we need to take what's called the seventh inning stretch right now. So 20 minutes, 20 seconds, everybody get up and get the blood circulating again.
Yeah, but you have to get angry to do it. You have to get angry.
Did you record this?
He's got some of dairy things.
Yes.
We still have to go down this side of the table.
You know, David had a teacher, Joanne Campbell, in his school.
20 seconds is over. 20 Let's seconds. Get back to it.
Right. Stand up, sit down.
This is the shortest 20 minutes I've had.
When you let them go on the farm, they don't come home.
So if elected mayor, I wrestled with this. How do you get information to people? And I like Terrence's idea with relation to the camera. Another issue is our emails. Because the reality is people are not going to come to the council chamber unless it affects them. But a lot of people would like to know what's going on. So if you had a combination of a camera where things are recorded, and we go out and solicit everybody's email, and the mayor or through council or one of the committees on a weekly or a monthly basis communicate to the public through their emails if they want it. If they don't want it, they don't have to take it. Items of interest, and even point to the time when they may or may not be on the council agenda. So if somebody sees something of interest via email, they can tune in that particular day. Because a lot of people are not going to take the trouble to go to the website to try and find out what the agenda is, because it's normally not on there until 2 or 3 days before the council meeting. So I think we have to be more proactive. Take it to the people, give them an opportunity through the technology that we have, email and cameras. I think Central Saanich is trying a test pilot project, and it's somewhere around the neighborhood of $12,000 to set it up, what the ongoing costs, and you have to really be careful with relation to staff costs. But I think we have to make it easy for people and let them know what's going on so they can tune in to tune out. Because the reality is they're not going to come. And what Terrence has said, if they do come, we've got to make it a friendly place so people feel comfortable. I've spoken to lots of people, and I feel intimidated going up and speaking to the council. Everybody's kind of looking at you like, what do you want here? So it's got to be a friendly atmosphere when they do get there, but most people aren't going to come, so we've got to take it to them.
Thank you, Mr. Milne.
I would think we just promote a comment box and then respond to every comment that comes in there. That's the simplest way to get feedback, I think, without intimidating people and having them come to council meetings. Simple as that.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Pearson. The barriers to communication are generally when people feel that they haven't been listened to. I've heard all the way down the table that it quickly wanes. You know, whatever people have tried, it just disappears. Mm-hmm. And generally that disappears because people feel that they haven't had a voice. And when they haven't had that voice, they're unlikely to ever repeat it again. So, the settings, when they're formalized, intimidate people. And that process, you're staring at, the real, and I like to say the real town hall of Suk is at A&W on Saturday mornings, and you get but you know what? When people feel that they can say what they want to say without somebody, CYA at every moment that, I'm a council member, so I'm afraid to say anything. When you get that open dialogue and people can respond, even if it's chucking it back and forth once in a while and you're having fun in the communication, then you're more likely to have it. I'm not sure what that venue is. I think less formalized settings are generally more receptive to most people, because then you feel like you're on equal footing. Now, we all heard that you're sitting in the chamber, and I've stood up there, and I'm not afraid to talk in public, but I'm intimidated by that process, and you've heard that a couple times on here. So you know what? I think you need to set up a coffee hall or a town hall where there's free coffee, or I don't know what it is free, or whatever that motivates people, but they have to feel at the end of it they've been heard. Thank you, Mr. Pearson. Ms. Rayon.
Thank you. I agree with a lot of the comments that have been made today about forms, but I think at the same time, whether you're at A&W or you're in the community hall, there has to be respect in that dialogue that occurs between the community and council. And I think that's just a basic common courtesy that needs to exist all of the time. And it's okay to disagree, and I think as council, we have to expect and understand that people are not always going to agree with us, but we don't have to be defensive about it. We don't have to get engaged in some sort of power shift. It's about listening, and I think we've heard that pretty well down the table. It's about listening and hearing what people have to say in an environment that's respectful. I mean, the other piece, I don't know about you, but I see those advertisements in the paper, all the legal stuff. I don't think it's particularly user-friendly that way. If we had an opportunity, we have the Suk Mirror and we have the Suk Voice, we get it on email, have sort of like a council corner where it's, basic information that's coming out about what we're doing rather than the legalities that tend to surround, because that becomes intimidating for lots of people, including myself. And so I think we have the form. I think it's how we manage it.
Well, I would like to thank the Suk Mirror and the Voice for coming out today. I think they do keep us informed. I read them all the time, and I enjoy both of them very much. There's lots of online polling. We could do online polling. We could do webcasting. I actually, on my website, have put up a poll. It seems a majority of people would like to see the webcasting in Sooke. So that's something that I would favor. I do believe that it can be intimidating. It's intimidating being on this side of the table looking out, never mind, you know, the other way around. And I think it's funny that we look out now and the questions are rolling now. You know, I think we need to create that kind of environment where everyone feels like when they stand up and say something, they won't be judged. And we need to get our counselors out, you know, into the communities. You know, I'm knocking on doors now, but I don't know if I'd stop if I got elected. I think I just might keep knocking and keep asking.
Thank you, Ms. Salzman. Ms. Tate.
Thank you, Michael, for the question. So, something different and something new. One thing I always thought of is a lot of counselors and staff volunteer and work in the community. So there's always that dialogue, and that's where you get a lot of feedback and a lot of input from a lot of different people. The challenge that I've always had is that the agenda typically comes out on a Thursday or a Friday, and then the meeting is on the Monday. So it's a very short time period to get feedback. What do you think about this? So I often wondered, well, what if you have the agenda come out, and then it's not for the meeting in like a week? So it comes out on the Friday instead of the meeting Monday. It's the following Monday. So that way that both the public, the news media can put out, this is coming to the council meeting. Anyone that's interested, say in a secondary suites or whatever, they can then go online, read the information, have time to think about it, and then either write something to a counselor or set aside the time to attend that meeting. Because it's a challenge. Like a lot of people, it's Monday, it's the start of the week, there's kids in school, there's a lot happening, you can't make it. And then they read about it afterwards. So it's like, well, gee, you know, if I knew that was coming, I would have attended. I would have either supported it or not, or spoken against it or whatever. But it's just, it's too short. And I think, you know, for myself, it's just been difficult. So you always try to say to people, okay, well, this is coming. Well, when? Well, it's coming in a few months, but I can't crystallize when exactly that is. So that would be my recommendation, is that you have it, there's always that time lag. And then that way also as a counselor, it gives you more time to read the material and get things done, because it's a challenge. Like, I'm almost at a point where I'm going to hire out the laundry. Like, it's a lot to get done. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Tate. Good comments from all candidates. Thank you. Next question, please.
My question is similar to what Mike asked, because I've been going to all the council meetings and I feel like I'm not being heard. I've also served on the OCP for 2.5 years, and same thing, I felt like I spent a lot of time in there and what happened wasn't what I heard from the people of Sooke. It didn't go through. We have things happening that didn't happen. So people give up and they don't come forward anymore. I understand that. And people don't come to council because, as some people have said here, because they feel intimidated. They don't like to have people rolling their eyes at them or being yelled at. Their knees are shaking as it is. And I sympathize with these people, but having done it for many times, I can handle that. Also being one of 12 children helps that all too. But Bev and Herb both brought up about the circle, forming a circle or having a that kind of communication, or Terrence brought that up. And we talked about that and talked about having that type of meeting. And I did go to the very first meeting. There was one council member was there, one council member only. I asked a number of questions. I never got those answers back, nothing. It was total zip. And then, so why bother going again? So the question I have, yes, I do, but I had to preclude it with what's going on. Okay, so. So what I'm asking is, there were some good answers here for making much more comfortable area, but what about an advisory planning committee? Would you support an advisory planning committee to council that would be taking care of some of the business of council so that people can come forward and maybe feel more comfortable in a group setting discussing some of the things that come forward, land use issues in particular.
Interesting question. Thank you. Would we like to go down the line and respond, starting with Ms. Tate?
Thank you, Ms. Lewis, for the question. I like the idea of an advisory planning committee. You know, we have a lot of talent and a lot of knowledge in the community, so it would be a matter of how the membership is made up, because you would want representation, especially with land use, from a representative from the Community Builders Association, someone from farms, someone that's worked in the area, because I find that that's very beneficial. So I would support that idea, especially on bigger projects where, you know, and there's not a lot of time. I know that we get the staff report and so on, but it does add a more informal area, and I've heard that other municipalities use them and they've been very successful with that. I do feel that if there was a committee, as a counselor, I would probably want to sit in the audience and just hear what the feedback is, so that I can be a part of that, not to speak at it, but to also just be present so you can get that engagement and get that learning and that knowledge there. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. T.
Yes, I would very much support the Planning Commission, and I know this great room down at the Prestige Hotel where you can meet once a month.
Thank you, Ms. Sullivan.
Absolutely. Consultation and engagement is big on my platform, so absolutely.
Thank you, Ms. Ray. Mr. Pierce.
Tentatively, I would support the Advisory Planning Commission as long as there's a measurement of its success, because we get bogged down in committee after committee after committee, and if they don't have teeth or a measurement or terms of reference of what that output is in a time frame, then it has to feel right to all using it. So it's a tentative yes. It's not a bad one.
Thank you, Mr. Pierce. Mr. Mitchell.
My answer is no, because this election is about electing a council that's going to do the planning for the community. Now, and as part of that process, I think there's lots of people in the community that are really experts in their specific fields, and if you've got a particular problem you're trying to resolve, you form a committee out of the community that can advise you on that, and that could be a changing committee. But as far as another body out there that's going to be advising, I don't think that's necessary.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Milne?
I would support on a trial basis providing its representative of the community, because I believe the committees, which should have a counselor on, should have a lot of this work done before it comes to council. And we're talking about reaching out to the community to get more information. This would be one way we could reach out with more people to get more information and a more broad-based opinion when we make our decisions. So I would support it. But like Kevin says, I think you got to make sure there's measurable performance, because we can't be just going awash in consultation and meetings and whatnot. We've got to make decisions, and that's what costs money, not making them. So I'd support it on a trial basis.
Thank you, Mr. Mill. Mr. Martin.
I'd be inclined to be very reluctant to enter into that. Same thing is, what's the effect going to be on taxes? Everything the government does costs money. Is it going to end up costing the cost benefit? If it's there, then why not? But I think the job of council is to get that input, and if council's not getting it, then they're not doing the job of getting up to the community, and there's lots of different ways they can do that outside of the council chamber. That's what they should be doing, is putting that time in. So I'd be inclined to avoid another layer of bureaucracy and adding delay into the development process. I think
Well, I'd be inclined to step it up a notch. Langford has had a land use and planning committee since its inception in the early 90s. They have three members of council that sit on that land use planning committee, and you could have anywhere between four and six members of the public, and they deal with all those matters before they go to council. So that's where you can hash everything out, get the public input. It's on a more friendly basis, it's less intimidating, and people feel comfortable. Council feels comfortable when they make the decision that committee did its work and they listened to what the public had to say. So they're comforted by the fact that a good, legitimate process took place to make those decisions the right decisions. So I think there's a way of doing it.
Thank you. Mr. Holding.
I would definitely support it. I mean, I used to be against the idea of it. Before, as a counselor, and I didn't quite understand it a lot. Gail pretty much told me how I had to learn to understand it. So I took it to a level where we now have official community plan, we have a transportation master plan, parks and trails plan, we have all these stuff in place. They're all done through the community. So we already have guidance through that. So if we did an APC, and I don't believe counselors should sit on an APC, I think it should just be the public. And that's just my point of view, because it's gonna have to come to us eventually anyway. And I watched them do that in a sense through the CRD. They Mike Hicks is, but they set everything apart there. And they get the people in the community, and they have a land use committee that talks about all this stuff, and then they bring it forward to another level of government that Mike sits on, the CRD board. And I think we need to do something like that, because what that'll do is it'll give the public a chance to feel like they're being involved, be heard from, and then some new ideas that we're not even thinking about may come to the table, and then they can bring them forward to us at a council meeting and tell us what they've come up with, what they found out. So I'd agree with Rob.
Thank you, Mr. Haldane. Mr. Duma.
Well, I've worked both sides of it. I've done with the committee and without the committee, and the biggest complaint of the public is it's a slow process. When you get that having to go through a series of committee meetings before they can get their answer, it has to go to the council. And that time lag could be 3 to 4 months. And that was one of the issues that has always been of the builders and the developers, was to get it done quickly. And that's why Langford went to the system they go. It actually doesn't get approved by the council. It is done without approval of the council. They take a shortcut right straight through to the bylaw, and they've got, their system has changed so much compared to ours. And we've been trying to expedite development permits and rezoning and things like that. And if we go to another system that has committee meetings of volunteers that you can't get, that's one of the other problems we had, is we couldn't get a quorum. So that means you have to hold it off another week until you can get a quorum. So it doesn't always work as well as it sounds on a piece of paper. And
thank you, Mr.
It would be nice to see it work for the community, but it's the developer that needs the expedition.
Thank you, Mr. Colbert.
I see this as something that might have many different titles. I feel that a committee, in the sense of local governance, in the sense of any governance, but in the sense of local governance right here, would be for looking into things at the discretion of council, and not to bring things up to council to plan for. I think if things come up in normal conversation during committee meetings, then there's always going to be some communications of unexpected. But I think that it would be very important to understand that the committee would be doing some of the breakdowns of things and trying to get out into the larger community with very particular items that the council comes and says, hey, we would like to get the citizens more involved and get more of a flavor of what they're thinking about this. I could see that being a proper place for an advisory committee that way. Again, I would like to reiterate that we need it to be directed and used as a tool of the council, right? And not being a directing tool to the council.
Thank you, Mr. Gilbert. Ms. Berger?
Thank you. I absolutely support anything that will enhance community involvement. But as said before by numerous other candidates, of course, there'd be a terms of referencing plan, and there'd be obviously guidelines that go by as every community that uses an APC does. So. Yeah, I think if it's effective and it is streamlined for the community, and any way we can get people from the community more into and out of all of it.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms. Peach.
Well, I think, excuse me, I think that we have had great conversations about this in council, and we have always gone back to the council. In the committee of the whole, we have considered that the council would be the advisory board. We tend to want to do that. We have asked and looked at it and thought about it. One of the issues I feel is a problem is that there are so many people working now that that could really hold it up. If you'd have to have everybody who's retired or has an ability to get there. And again, I don't think that we would want to be holding our developers up. It often seems to be a long enough process just as we have it. And so we have talked about it. and we've always gone back to the council as being that advisory board, and we, you know, if there's another way, if it's better. I mean, we just had a fire not long ago in the community, and a lady ran around all through the neighborhood trying to get somebody to, she could hear the smoke alarm, but she didn't have a cell phone, and there was nobody in a house anywhere around until some guys came by and you know, got the phone and phoned the fire department. So people are gone, you know. I'm walking up to the school with all the grandmothers, because the parents are all going, you know, they're all working. So it is hard, and if you suddenly say, okay, well, so-and-so can't be there, so-and-so can't be there, that really makes it difficult for the district. So if there's a special way of doing it that's easier than what we have had, I'm happy to stay with what we have.
Thank you very much.
The District of Sooke is not the only local government that uses the Committee of the Whole to be in effect at APC. I would hope that we would make sure it was a model that is best suited to our town's needs. I could support exploring the concept of having an APC.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Members of the community, we have time now for probably two more questions, unless there are others that need to come forward. Would you like to ask your question?
My question is to the
sir. Randy Clarkston. Randy Clarkston.
Thank you, Mr. Clarkston.
To the mayoral candidates, how are you going to stop the bickering and the problems that we've seen in council in the last two councils? What are you going to bring to the table that's going to stop that kind of, what do you call it? What's been going on for the last two councils where there's so much infighting and bickering amongst the council itself?
Do you have a specific issue that you care to address, Mr. Clarkston?
Just how they plan on stopping and how they're going to treat council so that they don't have that type of infighting and bickering.
Question from Mr. Clarkston has been addressed to the mayoralty candidates. Care to respond to Mr. Mill?
I will. I think I bring to the table the ability to bring people together, and that's really what I've done in my career with the RCMP and BC Transit, particularly in BC Transit, a large diverse work group with a lot of different ethnic backgrounds, a lot of issues, and a lot of things we had to do to get people to understand that different people have different views and different people think differently, and so it's all about bringing people together, and I go back to what I said earlier of being understanding. One of the issues I dealt with in BC Transit, I was one of the final arbiters on grievances. We had a large union component, three of them there, and so grievances would come up through the chain to me and get to me, and all the time I was there, I was able to resolve all the grievances without them going outside, because if you sit down and listen to both sides, usually each side has a couple of good points, and it's about listening to those points and getting to understand, yes, you got good points, and it's about everybody going home a winner. It's just that some people win a little less than others, and you've got to bring that to the table, and you've got to lead by example, I think, when you're dealing with people. You've got to be patient, understanding, and listen. The other big issue is facilitate. If you've got people, a couple of counselors that have a problem, I think you've got to get them aside and facilitate a discussion between them so they try and understand what they're doing and what each other's feelings are, because a lot of times people get into a personal dislike for each other, and they don't really even understand why it happened. It can go back to one simple little issue, and lots of times if you bring them together and get back to that little issue, the person that created the issue may say, geez, I didn't know I was doing that, and lots of times so you can solve this problem. So that's what I bring to the table. I've got a lot of experience in that area, and I think it's really important for the council to be able to set an example about getting along and treating each other with respect, so the community has some trust and can look up and say, well, hey, these are guys, you're doing a good job there. They're trying their hardest to make a decision.
Thank you, Mr. Mill. Mr. Bennett.
Thank you. I've been and worked with people for just over 65 years. I've had a variety of life experiences, both humbling and broadening. I've been a teacher and a school administrator for over 36 years in my previous life, and dealt with a lot of very interesting experiences and situations that were brought to me. I'm a listener. I look to work for consensus. I make decisions. I get things done. The most important thing for me as mayor would be to ensure the council respects and honors every decision that is made, whether it is a 7-0 vote or a 4-3 vote. Thank you.
Bennett, members of the community. One more question? There has to be one more question. Come on up. Come on over.
It's 9 o'clock and you come in.
I'm going to speak in here.
All right.
I've heard a lot of...
No intimidation at this table.
Okay, that's right. That's right. I've heard a lot of short-term vision about saving taxes and no bickering at council. But I'd like to, I put more importance on long-term planning. I see a lot of politicians making decisions for short-term gain, and long-term is just thrown out the window. So that's my thing, if I'd like to see. And what I would like to ask, and whoever wants to can answer, is what do you see as Souk in 20 years? And at that time, what do you think, what will be the percentage of people over 60?
That's a great question. I hope I'm here in 20 years to see Souk, quite frankly. But candidates, there's a good question, visionary question.
I'm coming from Air Manor in 20 years' time.
I'll probably be with a walk.
I envision a Souk that is accessible. I envision a Souk that is walker-friendly. I envision a Souk that has connecting trails and pathways for people of all mobilities, whether it's walkers or cyclists or joggers or whatever. I see a vibrant community in the downtown area that has benches and places for people to be sitting and enjoying the day and talking to each other. It's a pedestrian-friendly downtown core where you can walk down the street or the streets and utilize a number of businesses. We have a neighborhood shuttle system that allows people who may not live in the downtown core area or aren't as lucky as I am to be in Air Manor. They can access that bus system and come to the downtown area, do their shopping in local stores, support local businesses, and they can have a front row seat for some of the various eco and cultural activities that are continuing to take place in our incredible community. And I may not be able to sort of honor the wild by nature spirit, but I will certainly be there.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Speech.
I've had a vision of Souk for just about the minute I came, and I've lived in 10 different towns. And it's always got a future where people touch each other. And I mean that by bumping into each other. When I first moved here, I couldn't figure out what Souk Road did besides block us from going across to see our neighbors. And it still does that, but I'm hoping that that's going to change. I just wanted to have, I looked at it and thought, first of all, I thought it was Frontier. And just like Merritt, I lived in Merritt, it was Frontier too, but this was a beautiful Frontier that I was here. And I see it as people who, I want us to have the art of some kind of a building or a way that we're all going to greet in art, because that's what I saw from the beginning was the art. The very first time I saw the fine art show, I phoned the Kootenays and said, you won't believe what they do over here. They use their arena and they make it into an art gallery. And I look at us as being the most inventive people. But the thing that was missing, and the reason I wanted to be on the OCP, was that I said to people, we don't touch each other. We drive from Westerfoos to the village because we're afraid we're going to get hit by a car. Now, we do have that little pedestrian walkway now. I see us with our food security, valuing our farms. I would really hope that someday we'll be able to maybe have Wilfred's farm, because that's the most wonderful piece of property that we should be keeping for us, not letting anybody else have it. And I just see us growing into a community that really values each other. And I hope that's going to be something that we will be able to do in the future.
Thank you, Ms. Beach. Ms. Berger.
Thank you. 20 years from now, I'll only be 65, so I'll still be hopefully running amongst the streets here.
like I said, I was born and raised here, so I envision Souk to always be a community. I know that growth is inevitable and we are going to grow, but I hope that we grow in a positive way where we can keep our commercial hub, have more businesses available to us, where we can have a pedestrian-friendly town core as well as neighborhood centers. So, I mean, we all have this grand wish list of a beautiful community that we'll all live in, but I think that the economy is really going to deter us to where we're going to go. And again, if I have to go back to the UBCM conference I went to last week, the economists did show a graph for our area. And the second part of your question was how many people over 65 will live here. We're going to be mostly over 65. If he's bang on, and this economist was a very great speaker, his name is David Foote, and he put on a wonderful presentation about where we're heading as far as our age and as far as economy. And he foresees the South Island in particular being a retirement hub. So being at 65, I'll be in the right place. And hopefully everything will have the pedestrian path and we'll have everything that we need. But again, the economy is going to dictate, and hopefully we can push it in a positive route.
Thank you, Ms. Berger. Mr. Colbert.
I think this is a really important question. Thank you very much. It's very easy to think in the here and now and, you know, what we're not happy with at this moment. Investors and go that path. But I think that what is really important is when we look at how things will be for those that are after us, you know, how things are going to be down the road a little bit. You know, I hear that, and what I think of the most here in Souk is comfort. You know, where what people are now just getting used to as the core is going to become an actual incredible place. You are not able to go 20 years in the location what we have without development, without type of development that's going to mix commercial and residential in a nice high density way like most cores around the world. We're putting enough energy into it here already just to make it so that it's comfortable, and I mean that in a grand way. The extra large sidewalks that you've talked about, the non-porous nature, the importance of things that are non-porous. You know, we are at the rainforest. You know, I would say that what I've gained the most happiness in since I've been here is seeing that the actual care for everything, from the air to the water to the land, is of utmost importance. Everybody here, everybody, you know, I can't say they don't care about it or they don't, you know. We as a society have our little things that filter out, but boy, we care about what it's like here. And I think that 20 years from now, I'm going to be real happy.
Thank you, Mr. Colbert. Mr. Dumont, please.
I envisage that probably Air Manor will be three times as big as it is now. I think that one of the things that's kind of underused in our community, and that's our basin and our harbor. I'm hoping, and I've always hoped, that the federal government would come and suck out some of that stuff that came down out of the mountains because of the logging that we did, and make it a much more navigable harbor. I think that there's going to be a lot more activity around the harbor, and there's lots of people come here now just to use our zigzag to get down to the wharf. And I'm hoping that that'll continue around the community, and our property is going to have to reduce the size of our houses. We'll probably see much different society of buildings in Souk in the near future. 20 years, it'll probably be much more, small homes, small apartments, higher. We're going to have fire. Maybe no highway through the downtown core. We'll by that time put the Highway 14 outside the community, or farther out of the community. I doubt if we'll have a new bridge. I doubt if we'll have, we'll have a four-lane highway to Victoria. And sometimes I wonder, when I was regional director, I thought of putting up a gate on the highway there and only let so many in a year. Try and culture a real society here where it's Shangri-La. And I'd like to see it stay like that.
Thank you, Mr. Dumont. Mr. Haldane.
Well, I envision Souk obviously growing. Again, I mean, I talked about it earlier, touched on the fact that I think a lot of retirees are going to be moving here. I mean, we have fresh air, we have clean water, we have beautiful ocean and mountains and everything else. And with the regional district area, the way it's setting everything up, they're buying up parks and properties and everything. I envision this is going to be a playground for the more affluent and the fairly well-off retirees. I mean, they're coming here now, and if they say 17% is this number, they're going to be moving here in droves. So what that does is it creates a slight problem because there's an affordable housing component that's not being taken care of at this point. We have Sioux people that have been here for five, six, seven generations. We have to look after the fact that we have the old and the new. So at some point here, these people, they want their kids and their grandkids to stay here as well. So I think I envision this place as, you know, kind of a web where you're going to have the old and the new. You're always going to have the government service jobs in Victoria. You're always going to have the forces and the education and so on. But frankly, I believe that it's going to be pushed in a direction where this is going to be the place where everybody in this country wants to come to at some point. It's Southern Vancouver Island. It's British Columbia. And when we were in UBCM, they talked about the five most expensive places in the country, the entire country to live. Four of them are in British Columbia, and Victoria being number three. So I think this area is just going to keep growing. That fact, and the sad reality is the people that control the destiny of this, I mean, they're going to be people who are going to be generally of a higher age. So people who are younger or people who are the young families, they're not going to have a whole lot of control of what goes on and where the destiny is in this town. So at this point, we need to start understanding this and move the town in a direction that is equitable for everybody. Again, affordable housing is going to be a big thing.
Thank you, Mr. Haldane. Mr. Casper.
Well, I guess what I would like to see in 20 years is that we put the community values first and foremost, and that's why we made the decisions we did, or whoever's going to make those decisions took that into account. And that what we cherish and like about this community is still here 20 years from now, and the things we don't like are gone. And I'm sure everybody has different versions of what they don't like. And our children, and I get this from my wife, who's fifth generation Sioux, have to have some greater opportunities in this town. Otherwise, they're gone. They're scrambling right now. My son's 18, and he's wondering what he's going to do. And he looks around, are there opportunities for him in this town? Not very many. And that's sad. And I don't want to see that happen. Because if we want to have people around to look after those who are going to retire, and that percentage is going to go up, it'll more than double in 20 years. And the stats are all there. The demographics clearly show that you're going to have an aging community, and you're going to have people to look after that aging community. And if our sons and daughters can't do that in this community, we've got to bring them in from the outside. And who best to look after this community is our own sons and daughters who were raised here, have friends here, and like living here. So that's a huge challenge. And hopefully we can solve that for 20 years from now.
Thank you, Mr. Casper. Now, I'm sitting here at center court. I'm watching everybody with the crook in their neck leaning this way. I'm going to ask Ms. Tate to pick up the next comment and bring it back to center, if you would be so kind.
All right, thank you very much for the question. When I think about where Sioux's going to be in 20 years, I think about our volunteers. Volunteers have built this community, and they continue to lead the way. They get out there, they work together, and they create amazing things. So I think of Souk as having themed routes that bring goat culture, food, seaweed, water activities, and so on. I also see a diverse housing stock. Certainly that's something that council has discussed over and over, because it's about keeping people within the community and also enabling seniors to age in place. I see facilities for our youth, a positive working relationship with our First Nations, and a community that's vibrant, healthy, and safe. You see over and over plans coming across the table, our Grouse Nest, our town center in Silver Spray, so I suppose we might have cluster-type developments with trail linkages that bring all these different hubs together. But in the end, I do see a vibrant, healthy community, and I see it as a very exciting one. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Tate. Ms.
I just wanted to read this. It says, sustainability. It says, meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. And I think that sums it up. I would like to see a sustainable community.
Thank you, Ms. Sulzman. Ms. Reed.
Thank you. There has been lots of great thought and vision here at the table tonight, but I'd like to sort of approach it just slightly different and talk about more of the journey rather than the destination of that vision. And so for me, that journey means a process of developing a real strong sense of community that we've learned to manage through that time, our fiscal responsibility and spending, and that we have money in the bank. I also think it's about managing balanced growth, and through that time we learn that yes, we may have retirement coming in, but we still need the young, and we need the young families, we still need the working families to be part of a growing community. And that we've been open-minded to the possibilities of growth, and that maybe at times we have a vision, but maybe we need to tweak it, and we're open to making that movement to the left or to the right or to continue to go forward. But it's a healthy community that's thriving in 20 years.
Ms. Rabe. Mr. Pearson.
Well, that's a great question. And you know, as I was a little kid growing up here, I was hoping for a McDonald's one day so that I didn't have to go to Victoria. And I'm not sure that I was happy with that wish coming true, because, you know, I ate too much McDonald's. But you know, it's vision. Hopefully, I'm part of the decision-making process that makes Souk what it is today. And it is for our future generations. And those are only words. But I hope that there's fish in the Souk River. I hope that people can go out and enjoy the day on the coast without having to go through someone's backyard. That we've protected that essence of what Souk is about. We can't forget of where we've been. You know, our wonderful heritage and things that have been done for us in the past. So hopefully we're making decisions that protect what it is that we love about Souk now, that's there for an eternity, that we don't overspend and put ourselves into a situation where we can never pay that off, or that we mortgage our kids, you know, beyond there. And I hope that the children, my children and their children, can have that full spectrum of employment within their own community, but still retaining that essence of Souk. So, Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Pearson. Mr. Mitchell.
Thank you. If we can't do it in 3 years, and surely by 20 we can get proper street lights and sidewalks in Souk, that should be a reality. We want a safe community, we want friendly people living here, and people that are happy to live here. And I'd like to see less bureaucracy. I'd like to tear up the signed bylaws, an example, because we don't need bureaucrats going around to those small farmers telling them to take down their sign that says farm fresh eggs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mill.
So I'm going to confess one of my character faults to all you people here tonight. And that character fault is I'm impatient. I can't build a boat because I can't build it and get it in the water the same day. So I'll go back 13 years ago when we sat on an incorporation committee, and I had a vision. I had a vision that we'd have a little French downtown, we'd have sewers, and we'd have high density housing with little commercial businesses, and we'd have walkways, and we'd have lawn furniture, and we'd have all that stuff. So 13 years later, I go out and I trip over the asphalt curb. Nothing has changed. So we should really be talking about a vision 40 years from now if we're serious, if we keep going the way we're going. I think that the key to having a vision is also being able to convert that vision, to reality. And the reality is, if we want to reach any of these visions, or even any part of it, we've got to start working on our Common Core and making some basic block-by-block changes to it. Otherwise, we're going to be talking about our vision 10 years from now, and I don't think we're going to be any further ahead. So I just think we've got to, we've studied this to death. I think we need to put some plans in place to take some basic steps that aren't expensive, but it's step-by-step, block-by-block, to try and make some improvements. And maybe we'll start working towards this vision, I think, that we all share.
Thank you, Mr. Milne. Mr. Martin.
I tend to agree. It's a journey, and a journey begins with the first step. However, when I look forward 20 years, I'm trying to make me think what happened the last 20. And I hope we're 20 years into a 100-year plan. I have some First Nations friends, and that's how they do their plan. Literally 100-year cycles. They're not interested in what happens a couple of months out. But it all requires immediate steps to get there. When I'm looking that far out, I look to my children and my friends. I hope I have children and their children living in houses that they were born in and have friends that they grew up with. I'm a newcomer to Souk, and frankly, I'm jealous of a lot of my friends. They're old-timers around Souk, and they've got friends that they grew up with. They're people in their 50s, 60s, 70s. And that's nice feeling. It's a sense of community, and I hope that stays. I hope the culture maintains its focus, that it's less about the place and more about the people. It keeps that.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Ladies and gentlemen, our time has passed, and I would like to say this to all of us in the community. It's been very, very enlightening, I believe, from my perspective, to hear the vision of the candidates and how they would like to see us move forward. Obviously, the viewpoints are diverse, some common, but some diverse. Not all of the people at this table will be in council chambers in December, but I think that we have to, as the community, thank them most sincerely for giving of their time and contributing to the stewardship of Souk. And I'd ask you to join me with an applause and thanks. That's correct.
Every 2 minutes.
My 2 minutes are up.